up there have a camera that is in that room. They can see all that's going on, so you can feel comfortable that they are well watched over and taken care of. We're excited about the fact that second floor being finished and ready for our children. On Wednesday night, they had 108 kids up there. This morning, we are. Well, let me before I get that. If you have children that are from those kids end with the second grade, but our third, fourth, and fifth graders are all in here. And last week, Jennifer told you about a new process we have here. And on the front pew up here next to the adult bulletins are some children's bulletins. And so what she's doing is there's some bags out here in the hall, little tote Sunday school or church bags for kids that age. They have colored pencils. They have a regular pencil. And then they can take one of these bulletins. We encourage you to take the bulletin home with you, but to take those bags back and deposit them back out here, and we'll have them ready for you next week. That way you don't have to remember to bring them. But it will help children to keep up with the sermon. The questions and things on there relate to the sermon. You say, well, can they really do it? Listen, I've got a daughter that started that real early on, and today she still takes notes during sermons. And I think it's setting our children to help them understand. You listen, and there are points you can pick up even at their age. I have a picture on my wall in my office that is my portrait. Some little girl, years ago in Virginia, there was a place, draw a picture of the pastor. And so my picture's in there. Now, she came from a Presbyterian background, and so I have a collar on that one, but that's okay. It's kind of neat, and I've kept that and actually framed it. So I encourage you to take advantage of that and help our children get more out of the service each Sunday. We're still in our study, and actually just the second week in our study in the book of Zechariah. Last week we looked at a different kind of jealousy. We're going to continue that today. Well, last week we looked at some anger. This week we'll look at jealousy. And this particular different kind of jealousy is going to fall into two sermons this week and next week. You know, as I look at the movies that are available today, and even some of the television shows, what I have found is that many of them have this futuristic focus. It's, you know, all the, I don't know, for our grandkids, it's the Transformers and now the zombies and all this kind of stuff. And honestly, it gives me a reason to change channel, because it is so disconnected from reality that I just go, yeah, I'm going to find something else to watch or something else to do. Well, I believe that many Christians today do that very similar thing with the Bible. You get to certain places in the Bible and you read it and you go, this is weird. I mean, think about it. Things like colored horses, horns, craftsmen, flying scrolls. And you read through that and you go, yeah, okay, that doesn't make sense. Let's move on to something else. And we just read over it, gloss over it, because we don't know what it means. It doesn't make sense to us. But what if I were to tell you that embedded in those are beautiful pictures of who our God is, the God that we love, the God that loves us, the God we serve? We can see Him in this, and it will help us understand why we can trust Him. Well, then if I told you that, maybe you would say, okay, well, then I need to really dig a little deeper and find out what this means. And that's what we're dealing with in the book of Zechariah. We're moving into a very fascinating portion of Zechariah where God gives him several visions, and they are filled with imagery but that were relevant in his day. But let me tell you, that's still relevant today, and it will be relevant until the end of time. And so we've just got to dig into it and see what it is. We've got to find out, and he shows him this in a series of visions. Now, vision and a dream is different. A dream tends to be when you're asleep. A vision is normally when the person is fully awake and coherent and has all his faculties about him, and so this vision takes place, and that's what we find here. God comes to Zechariah and gives him a series of visions, and we're going to look at the first vision today. Sometimes when we read these visions, again, we struggle. We struggle trying to understand what they mean. It would have been different for the people of Zechariah's day. Let me give you this illustration. Maybe it will help you. If I were to come in today and I say, you know, this morning I got up and I got dressed, and during Sunday school I was sitting in the prayer room back there and God gave me a vision. And in that vision, there was a convention of eagles. That's a group of eagles flying overhead. I mean, a bunch of them. And I looked up, and there were white eagles, and there were red eagles, and there were blue eagles. Now, without me saying anything else, if you think you know what the subject of that is, what the imagery is, just raise your hand. Okay, quite a few people. Somebody tell me. America. How do we know that? Well, the eagle is our national bird. Red, white, and blue are our national colors. And so you put all that together and you go, oh, yeah, we get it. But let me tell you something. Somebody from another country or another time wouldn't get it. They would look at that and go, well, number one, eagles aren't solid white, solid red, and solid blue. So that doesn't make sense. And eagles don't normally fly in large conventions. They fly singularly, or maybe a couple of them together, but they're not like geese. And so you'd look at that and go, well, this doesn't make sense. But to you and I, because it's set in our context, we understand it. Well, please understand, that's the same thing that took place with this vision. When this vision was given to Zechariah, it was understood. Now, he had some questions, and that's going to be answered, but it made perfect sense to him. And I believe if we will look at it today, we'll see where it makes perfect sense to us, and it gives us a peace beyond our circumstances. So the first thing we're going to see today is that in this vision, Zechariah sees that our God is a God of comfort that overcomes adversity. Would you stand with me as we read Zechariah chapter 1, verses 7 through 17. On the 24th day of the 11th month, which is the month of Sabbat, in the second year of Darius, the word of the Lord came to the prophet Zechariah, son of Bechariah, son of Iddo. Zechariah writes, I looked out in the night and saw a man riding on a red horse. He was standing among the myrtle trees in the valley. Behind him were red, sorrel, and white horses. I asked, what are these, my lord? The angel who was talking to me replied, I will show you what they are. Then the man standing among the myrtle trees explained, they are the ones the Lord has sent to patrol the earth. They reported to the angel of the Lord standing among the myrtle trees, we have patrolled the earth, and right now the whole earth is calm and quiet. Then the angel of the Lord responded, how long, Lord of hosts, will you withhold mercy from Jerusalem and the cities of Judah that you have been angry with these 70 years? And the Lord replied with kind, comforting words to the angel who was speaking with me. So the angel who was speaking with me said, proclaim, the Lord of hosts says, I am extremely jealous for Jerusalem and Zion. I am fiercely angry with the nations that are at ease, for I was a little angry, but they made it worse. Therefore, this is what the Lord says, I have graciously returned to Jerusalem. My house will be rebuilt within it, the declaration of the Lord of hosts, and a measuring line will be stretched over Jerusalem. Proclaim further, this is what the Lord of the hosts says, my cities will again overflow with prosperity. The Lord will once more comfort Zion and again choose Jerusalem. Lord God, we thank you for your word. We ask that your Holy Spirit, who is now here in our midst, would be our teacher today. Help us understand not only what you were saying to Zechariah, but what you say to us today. And may we be changed because of your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. First thing I want you to notice in this text is the jealousy and the anger of God. Now, most of the time when we think of jealousy and anger, it is something that is negative. We'll say we have righteous anger, but that's just because we saw it in the Bible somewhere and we thought we'd claim it to justify our own anger. The truth of the matter is, I've seen very few times human beings have true righteous anger. Because righteous anger is not about the way it affects us. God's anger is a righteous anger. Ours is normally a selfish anger. But also the Bible says that God is jealous. And we think of jealousy as being really kind of a bad thing, especially when we see people react in some awful, weird ways, and angry, and jealousy and anger just seems to go together, and it's never a good thing. But with God, it is different. Because God is holy, God is perfect, and so if he has anger and he has jealousy, then it can't be a bad thing, because he will never act against his nature. And so in this issue here, the Hebrew puts a magnifying glass. It increases the understanding of it, and if you read it directly from the Hebrew, it would translate, our God is jealous with a great jealousy and angry with great anger. So it highlights the fact that this isn't just your run-of-the-mill stuff. This is a heightened level of this. In the Bible, it's interesting to notice that every time it talks about the jealousy of God, it refers to his response to the unfaithfulness of his people. And so we can apply it in Zechariah's day to the children of Israel, to the people of God at that time, but we can move it forward into the New Testament time and apply that to us, to his church, to Christians, to believers, to children of God. Whether it was Israel turning from God to idols, or whether it is Christians who today turn from God to start acting like the lost, unregenerate world, we need to remember that God's jealousy is a response that outflows from his love for us. I think we said last week, he's not up there with a mallet waiting to whack us, but he loves us so much, he is driven to a holy jealousy. When we think about that jealousy, we think about him being jealous due to his passionate commitment to that which is rightfully his. In other words, he redeemed us, and so we're his. If you think about that for a moment, what is rightfully his? His glory. To him and him alone is due the glory. But what happens when God's people, whether Israel or Christians today, give the glory to someone other than God? Does he not have a right to be jealous? He's the only one that paid the price. He was God. He was pre-incarnate Christ. And he came to earth and he paid the price of a painful death that he didn't deserve so that we might be redeemed. And so all the glory goes to him. What about his worthiness to be the only one worshipped as the one true God? But the children of Israel went off and they started worshiping idols, and they didn't do away with the worship of God. They just added more idols to it, almost like an insurance policy. We believe in the one true God, but these people over here, they say this God is powerful, so we won't do away with our God, but we'll add another one just in case. And God says, no, I'm a jealous God. I'm not going to have anybody else that you worship. Worship me and me alone. And we'd look today as Christians and we'd say, oh, we would never do that. What do we worship? Who do we worship other than the one true God? Now, we don't put that twist on it and we don't talk about it like that. But if we look at where we put our time and our energy and our money, would it not show up that we worship things other than the one true God? Our priorities are for everything else. And even good things can become idols. There's nothing wrong with a job. It's a good thing. But if that job becomes your total focus, it takes the place, and I can't go to worship, and I can't serve God because I've got to work all the time. Work, good thing, can become a bad thing if we worship it and put it before God. Family, as important as family is, if we put family before God, and I'm not even talking now, I'm not saying family before church, because that's family is to be right there under God, but listen, if we put family before God, then we're worshiping a unit that He made, He created, but He never created it to be above Him. And so we are to worship only God. And if we don't, then that drives that passion He has, that passionate commitment for us and toward us is driven to jealousy. What about the affections of His people? Do we really love Him? I mean, really? Do we chase after Him? Or do we split the time with other things? What about the devotion to Him by His people? Are we committed to Christ? He deserves it. He's worthy of it. So see, we can go through and probably as I gave you that list of four things, there were some things that came to your mind that you said, yeah, that would be wrong. That would be something that would drive God to a jealous action. And so you say, well, Pastor, I hear all of that and I read these verses, but how on earth do these verses help us understand that God is a God of comfort? Well, maybe this will help. Let me explain some of the terms here. It says, he saw this man in the myrtle trees, the myrtle bushes, if you will. The myrtle is more, to me, is more of a bush than a tree, kind of like a mesquite's more of a bush than a tree. If you come from East Texas, where there are real big trees. And so you've got the myrtle, and you say, well, what's the deal with that? Well, at one time, the myrtle was so prevalent in Jerusalem and in Israel that it almost became and could often be used as a synonym for Jerusalem. Myrtle. It'd be like where Jerry and I grew up in the southeast Texas area. We were known, Cleveland, their slogan was the gateway to the piney woods. And so people would say, where are you going? I'm going to the piney woods. We've got a lot of advertisements. Come to the piney woods of East Texas. You can't say that in Iowa Park. Come on, folks. Come to the mesquites. But there are places you can go. You can go down around the Pearland area and then over a little west of there. And there are some oak trees down there that two or three of us could get together and grab hands, and we couldn't reach around them. And so you talk about going down around the mighty oaks. You can go out into California. You've got the big red oaks up north up there. And so we're identified. And so what this is doing is saying for the people in that day, they understood this was identifying with the people of Israel. The setting was in the valley. Well, what's a valley? A low place. You ever been in one of those? Just a low place in life? So that's what he's saying, that here was this person who was amongst the people, the myrtles, who were in a place in the valley, in a dark place, in a low place in life. Actually, it was dark. So you've got darkness, you've got the valley, you've got the people there. But look what's taking place. This man that he sees is in the middle of all that. He's not standing on a hill looking down. He is in the midst of his people, and that's what the picture is here. He is in the midst of his people in their humble state, in their lowly state at the time. Remember, they have been in captivity for 70 years. The temple and the city has been destroyed. And although they're coming back to their land, it's in ruin, and the people are still against them. And so they're in this very difficult time in life, but here is this man on this red horse that is right in the middle of them. Now, what's the deal with the horses? Well, number one, the key figure here is on a red horse. And then there's another red horse. And in the Bible, red often symbolizes war. So maybe we'd say it's a war horse. And so a mighty warrior. How many times have you heard Jesus called the mighty warrior? And so he's on this red horse. But then there's this other red horse that symbolizes war. There's a white horse that symbolizes peace. And then there's this brown or speckled horse. What do you do with him? Well, it is that time between war and peace, that in-between time, when things aren't great, but they're somewhere between great and real bad. As I was preparing this, I could think of multiple countries in this world today who we're really not at war with, but we sure aren't at peace with. That kind of in-between stage. So all of these horses represent war, peace, and something in between. Now the first rider on that red horse, he refers to him as the angel of the Lord. Remember, we're in Old Testament times. So Jesus hasn't shown up on the scene yet in bodily form. But don't let anybody convince you that Jesus isn't on the scene. Jesus is pre-existent, just like God. He is God, the Son. And so he was at the creation. He was before creation. So when you see this in the Old Testament, many times this is what we call a theophany, or it is a presentation of the pre-incarnate Christ. Christ prior to his birth and him taking on flesh. And so Christ himself shows up riding this red horse, and it is Jesus that he is talking to. The whole scene is provided to give Israel, as well as Christians today, comfort even when you're in the valley, even when things look desperate, even when our situations are the result of our own sin. Over and over and over again, Israel disobeyed God and then had to deal with the consequences of that. But folks, it's the same God today as it was back then. Christians over and over and over again disobey God and then suffer the consequences. And sometimes when you're in the midst of those consequences, you feel like God is totally gone. God is not a part of anything that's going on. But this passage helps us see that he is right there with us. And his desire is to bring us comfort, even in our difficult situations, even in our dark places, even in our low valley places. We can be assured that he is here with us. He has an unfailing love. And he could be counted on for an overcoming comfort. There are at least four ways here that God extends his comfort to us. Number one, he is concerned for our situation. He knows what's going on because he's constantly surveying the situations on earth in all directions. The picture here was these horsemen had ridden out, and they took report, and they brought it back to him, and they said, hey, it's quiet. It is calm all over the earth. Now today we understand that God is spirit, Christ is spirit, and he knows what's going on all the time, everywhere. Nothing's hidden from him. Which means we can be sitting here this morning worshiping God, and he knows what's taking place right here. But my daughter and her family are in Fredericksburg, Virginia, and they're worshiping God. They're about to get out. Actually, they're out. They're an hour ahead. But same God, same time, both places. You can go overseas, the same thing. There's no place that he is not there. so he is concerned about our situation. He's not just bird's eye on top of us. He knows what's taking place out here. Those things kind of surprise us sometimes when they hit us, but he knew it was coming. He knows what's getting ready to take place. Number two, Jesus intercedes on our behalf. This is something I read it twice before I caught it. Do you see who's speaking in verse 12? Then the angel of the Lord responded, "How long, Lord of hosts, will you withhold mercy from Jerusalem and the cities of Judah that you have been angry with these 70 years?" That wasn't the angel standing beside Zechariah telling him what's going on. That's the guy that's in the myrtle trees. And he's talking to God. So Jesus is interceding for the children of Israel, and he's saying, "Father, how long are you going to make them suffer? How long are you gonna? You've been angry for 70 years. How long?" Now I don't know about you, but that's pretty comforting for me to know that Jesus, our Savior, is mediating and interceding for us to the Father. He's saying, "Cut them some slack. They need help. They're returning. They're repentant." He's speaking on our behalf. So we need to understand he is our high priest. He is the one at the right hand of the Father today. He is the one and the only mediator we need. I don't need Dennis. Now, I appreciate Dennis praying for me, but I don't need to go to Dennis and say, "Dennis, can you pray for me so God will hear?" God's going to hear me. But we both go through Jesus, and he's the only one we need. He's the one that takes the message to the Father. Number three, God speaks words of encouragement. Verse 12, Jesus is asking God, "How long?" Look at verse 13. And the Lord replied with kind, comforting words to the angel who was speaking with me. Think about this. This is the God that was angry. This is a God that sent them into Babylonian captivity. This is a God that dealt discipline upon the children of Israel, but he now speaks with words of comfort. God's love does not diminish when he has to discipline us. As a matter of fact, I believe it is a beautiful picture of how much he loves us. And now he speaks words of encouragement, comforting words, kind words. And number four, the Lord is intimately present in our lives. He is not detached from his people. He is among the myrtle trees, in the valley, in the darkness. Psalm 34:18 says, "The Lord is near the brokenhearted. He saves those crushed in spirit." You don't ever have to feel alone. Because if everybody else leaves you as a child of God, you can have the encouragement and the peace to know that God is right there with you in whatever you're in. So God's people can be assured of comfort from our Lord, who is with us, who is in us. But also in this first vision, we can see that our God is full of overflowing mercy. Not just comfort, but mercy. Again, remember the setting. The writer have gone out and they've reported that everything is calm and everything is quiet over the whole earth. You say, isn't that a good thing? Well, what if you're Israel? Some of you are back in your land, but it's destroyed. Everything is in shambles. The place that you loved so, the place that God had promised you and gave you, is now torn down. And even in the idea of rebuilding it, there's opposition. And they're bigger than you are and stronger than you are. So, is it really a good thing that everybody else is at peace? You say, well, it's good they're at peace. But wait a minute, many of them were the ones that put you in this situation in the first place. They were the nations that had conquered you. And so they're living in peace while you're living in shambles. Well, we have to remember God disciplined Israel for their disobedience. And he either allowed evil nations, or I believe you can say that he appointed or ordained evil nations to oppress his people. He will use whatever means he chooses to bring us back to himself. And so God used these evil nations, these pagan nations, to bring disaster upon his people. And the whole goal was to bring them back, to get them to repent and turn back to him. And while that's going on, it's easy to think that God loves them more than he loves us, because they're living in peace. They seem to be victorious. They won the battle. They're having the party, and I'm still struggling. Even after I've said, Lord, I'm sorry. Lord, I'm truly sorry. I'm not just sorry that I got caught. I'm really sorry. Lord, I turn back to you, and I want to follow you. But I'm still struggling. They're not. Hard place to be. Hard place to understand. Why would God? How could God do this? See, we try many times to discount the severity of our sin. And we look at it and go, you know, we might be your people, or we are your people, and we might have done something wrong, but God, it's really not as bad as what they're doing. But see, that's a misunderstanding of what sin is. Sin is not in comparison to somebody else's sin. We have to look at sin. The severity of sin is in direct relation to the holiness of God that we sin against. David even said he had sinned against a nation. He had sinned against Bathsheba. He had sinned against her husband. He had sinned against all kinds of people. But he said, against you and you alone have I sinned, Lord. Because he recognized the magnitude of his sin up against the holy God overshadowed, overpowered any other relationship. And so it is against the holy God. All sin is severe because of the holiness and the righteousness of God. And he will go to great lengths to bring us back to himself. That's how much he loves us. There have been a few times in churches that we've gotten calls and family members are saying, you know, my son has gone off and he's out somewhere and he's called home and he desperately wants to come home and he's sorry for what he's done and we want to help him and we just don't know how we're going to get him back here. There have been times that we met with our benevolent committee and we talked and looked at the situation, and as a church we literally helped get that son or that daughter back home. That family was willing to go to whatever it cost. They just needed some help with it, but whatever it cost to get them back. That's where God is with us. Anytime we stray, anytime we sin, anytime we go our way, and anytime we reject him, he's always loving us so much that he will go to great lengths to draw us back to himself. But never think, because he's using pagans to bring judgment, because that's part of his process, never think that means he doesn't love us. He doesn't love you. He is motivated by his love for us. The magnitude of his actions, both from our viewpoint, the positive and the negative, are directly related to the magnitude of our stubbornness and disobedience and our desire for repentance. He goes to great lengths to deal with us when we are disobedient, but he goes to great lengths to deal with us when we're repentant, because the whole goal is to bring us back to himself. And also, never think that the pagans are getting by with it. It's easy from our difficult standpoint to sit and go, look, they've won. It's not over. He will take care of it. See, although God allowed or directed their actions, they were more than willing to participate. He didn't have to twist Babylon's arm. He didn't have to overrule their desires. No, their desire was to come against Israel. They were more than happy to take on the role of the people that would oppress Israel and that would take them captive. And not even really because of their Israelites, because of the Israelites' God. Let me tell you, even today, the nations that go against God's people, whether we're talking Israel or whether we're talking the church, the people that come against God's people are more than willing participants in trying to defeat. Do you really think that all of these folks that are trying to get rid of biblical, spiritual things in our world today, in our country, are not more than willing to be used by whatever means just to do it? Do you think that even if God, and I believe in many cases He is using different things today to bring the church back to Himself, do you think those people He's using to do that are going, no, I don't want to do this? And He's going, yeah, you got to. No, they're willing to say yes because they're against God in the first place. And so their action, although against the church in the Old Testament, although against Israel, and even in the New Testament against Israel, they are really against God. Their violence is against His people because their heart is to ultimately try and defeat God. So His anger toward them burns hotter and hotter because of their actions and their enjoyment of doing it. And He says, He said, I was a little angry and now I'm very angry. But here's what you and I have to do. And here's what the Israelites had to do. We've got to let God be God. Let Him take the vengeance. Let Him deal with it. Because He'll do a much better job than we could ever deal with it. So allow Him to be God. What we need to do is focus on God's mercy. We must remember His merciful promise for the Israelites, Deuteronomy 30, 1 through 3. When all these things happen to you, the blessings and the curses I have set before you, and you come to your senses, hello church, and you come to your senses while you are in all the nations where the Lord your God has driven you, and you and your children return to the Lord your God and obey Him with all your heart and with all your soul by doing everything I'm giving you today, then He will restore your fortunes, have compassion on you, gather you again from the peoples where the Lord your God has scattered you. See what He's doing? Saying, all you got to do is turn. All you got to do is repent, and I'll gather you back to myself. His mercy is always at work to restore us. And that's just not just, that's all His repentant people. Due to His mercy, He makes four promises and we'll be finished. He promises His returned presence. Now, we know in the New Testament time, the presence of God never leaves us because the Holy Spirit indwells us. Once we believe Christ is the one that died for us and we accept Him as our Savior, we commit our life to Him, the Bible tells us that the Holy Spirit takes up residence inside of us, so He never leaves. But let me tell you, when we quench the Holy Spirit, when we're disobedient to God, we can cause that, not the actual presence of God through the Holy Spirit, but the manifest presence of God, the working presence of God, to be damaged. And this, we can change that. Just like He said in Deuteronomy, that can be changed if we will repent. He promises to restore stability. His presence always restores stability. If you want to know why your life is spiraling out of control, where's your relationship with God? Now, I'm not going to say nothing bad happens to you. I'm not a health and wealth and all that kind of preacher, because that's a lie from the devil. But I tell you what, when God, the Holy Spirit, is in your life and He is manifested in your life and you're obedient and He's working, there might be some difficulty, but even in the difficulty, there will be stability because you know you can count on Him. He wants us to remain faithful to Him and have an ever-growing relationship with Him. And when we do that, we learn to navigate even the struggles of life with more balance. Number three, He promises rich blessings. The people had their part to do in rebuilding the city. It was going to take work on their part to do the city and the temple, but God greatly supplied their needs. We look at things today and go, how on earth can we do that? Well, it's going to take our obedience. It's going to take our obedience in serving Him. It's going to take our obedience and our trust in giving Him the tithe, giving Him what's His, giving Him what He asks. But then He will supply the need. As whether we're talking about the church as a group, the corporate body, or we're talking about our individual lives. You say, I hear people all the time say, well, I'm not sure, I just can't afford to. Wait a minute. If God tells you to do it, and He's already laid out what you're supposed to do, if you'll just be obedient to Him, He will supply all that you need. It's been proven over and over and over again. And then finally, He promises renewed favor. Proverbs 3, 1 through 4. My son, do not forget my teaching, but let your heart keep my commands, for they will bring you many days of full life and well-being. Never let loyalty and faithfulness leave you. Tie them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. Then you will find favor and high regard in the sight of God and man. So this morning, if you're a child of God, if you're not and you become a child of God through placing your faith and trust in Him, if you're a child of God who's strayed but ready to repent and ready to return, let me tell you, God never stopped loving you, and He loves you today. And He wants to bring comfort, and He wants to show His mercy. God loves you with His unique, wonderful, jealous love. You can depend on Him. No matter what you're going through, no matter how dark, no matter how deep in the valley it seems that you are, He's waiting. He's there. He's amongst you. He's amongst us. So what do you need to do? Are you here this morning and you don't know Him and you need to commit your life to Him? Would you do it today so that you can be in His presence, so that He will indwell you with His Holy Spirit? Maybe you've done that and you're a child of God, but you're not connected to a local church. He puts us together. Notice He wasn't standing next to a lone myrtle out there. He was standing amongst the myrtle trees. God puts us in community for a purpose. Do you need to join and be a part of the community of God? Are there things in your life that you've wandered away? Maybe He's brought some calamity and you're angry at Him. Please understand that the reason He does that is to draw you back to Himself. When I disciplined my children, I never did it because I hated them. I never did it because I was, well, most of the time I didn't do it because I was angry at them. That was the bad human side of me when I disciplined them out of anger. But God disciplines like most of us discipline our children. He disciplines out of love. So will you respond to Him? I don't know what's going on in your life. I don't know where you are, but I know we have a God that wants to comfort you and wants to show you mercy out of His great, jealous love.